Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
The meeting will now come to order. Don't pay attention to that clock. It says 6 o'clock. I'm like, oh, the clock's not right. Okay, if we can bow in prayer, please. I'm going to have the invocation. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for watching over us, Lord, and just pray that we'll do the right things for Alamance County tonight, Lord. We pray for all of our Army and Navy and all of our military men overseas, Lord, that you can bring them home safe. And just watch over us tonight as we go through the meeting. And these things we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Next thing is public comments. I don't have any, so we won't have any. And Miss Bailey, you were next. If you'll come on.
I just got my agenda.
Oh. Well, just come on up here to the podium and just have at it, girl.
Come on down.
Come on
down.
That
was all about Uncle Eli's quilt.
Eli.
That's right.
I just happened to have some flyers. Would you like to have one about Uncle Eli's quilt and
party? I think we have one. And
would you like to pass them around?
That's yes, fine. Just what it, you certainly may.
Just you may.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Have one. Is this the microphone for us or somebody left their phone?
That's for that screen up there, honey. So just,
that's a taser for
Boyd. You don't have to use that. You don't have to use that.
We love you, Bob.
I'm going to ask you, tell you something and ask you something.
Yes, I wore feet set dresses. Go ahead.
Okay. You just ruined my speech, ma'am.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You're not either. Uncle Eli's quilting party, mm-hmm. First Thursday in April for 79 years. How can we get a road sign? Anyway, that.
Come to your state house representative. They can get
I just took on the.
Actually, Pat went and talked to Mr. Conte, Department of Transportation head.
And he said they couldn't afford it.
I can't believe that.
Then I got to talk with Mike Mills. Expensive. They got to investigate the state laws, got to investigate the federal laws. I said, I just want a directional sign. Anyway, it is way down the country, Uncle Eli's Quilting Party. For those who don't know, Uncle Eli's Quilting Party, Eli Whitney Community Center. No, Recreation Center, whatever they want to call it this week. But many come from out of the area, and they overshoot the crossroads and go to Pittsburgh and places around just to tell them up that way.
I don't know if it's on our website or not, we could get it on there as points of interest or places of interest in Alamance County.
I believe it is also on the Chambers Convention Bureau as well. So.
Yes, but when the ladies drive down there, when you get 7 or 8 miles out of town, they think they're in the country.
I guess we'll just have to get one and make one.
Pay. Yeah, that's an idea.
Well, I've gone from the DOT chairman to the next one on down, and now I've got down to you people now.
Well, they're not that expensive to make. We'll talk just, about it.
Okay. I mean, it's not just a quilt. It's not just a social quilting party, tea party. It's a folk custom for 79. It's the only thing like it in North Carolina that we have any records of. And we'd like people to show up there instead of going to Pittsburgh and places around. This year, there will be quilts all around the room. Thanks to the Recreation Department who helps us, I hope, if they're here to listen.
He's here.
Yeah, Brian's back there.
You still with us?
Absolutely.
Need some extra tables this time. something came out in the paper, like four columns had about a quilt. Now, how about a newspaper in the South about a quilting party? That's us. All right. I've gotten calls from Clayton, North Carolina. Said, could they come? Could they wear their feed sack clothes? We're going to show feed sacks this time. We had many requests for people showing. I've got some Kernersville and place around, but. Folks, come to think about it, Alamance County has something it's famous for and didn't realize. You got the Alamance Plaid. If you take a quilt or someplace, they go, oh, it's Alamance County. Feed sacks material is so rare now that people said, oh, you got a feed sack. Alamance County grew up on feed sacks. With them, wore them, underclothes, outer clothes, tablecloths. I call Paul McBain, that. I mean, fertilize. Paul White came telling me. He says, "Oh Lord, my mom made the mattress for a mattress cover for a straw tick." Now, for those who know what a straw tick is, a mattress filled with straw. And it goes on and on there. Well, there are different kind of feed sacks. There's cow feed and chicken feed, and some people, the city folks, call it chicken linen. But over the years, that times have been tough, and the ladies noticed that the sacks came out, and they came out with all this kind of printing on them. Just happened to find one of them. And so the ladies, the word got back to the manufacturers that, why can't you put prints on them? So then the manufacturers started competition, see who gets the prettiest one. And they could be flowers or stripes or plaid, and this has got a hole in it. And then they copy it, and then they make little quilty things. This is not feed sack, but it's a replica of what could be. We got so many requests, we being Nanlu and Milton and I, could they show off their feed sack? So this year, we're asking people to bring and show and tell their feed sack things. It's either going to go big or not, because I've got calls from all around saying, are you sure? Are you sure that you let me in? So anyway, come and bring your feed sacks. Come and wear your feed sacks. Uncle Eli's Quilting Party, first Thursday in April. Now, March of 08, a board of commissioners ruled that Uncle Eli's Quilting Party was a special event. Do we have to come back to you people every year and say, recognize us, proclaim something, make it Uncle Eli Day? What can you do to call attention to the public that?
I think we have the one from that.
The resolution for that.
Pat. I talked with this Pat about it, and we do have one. And we can just, do you want me to read it?
No, I want you to send it to the papers.
There we go.
If Boyd's listening, Bob's listening, all right. Here's a quilting party thing for you. You get one?
Okay. Oh, he will be there. He's got a feminine side.
Oh, does he? But yes. Can he sew? It used to be the rule was that everybody went to the quilting party was invited to sew a stitch.
He can do that.
Any age, any gender, any color, whatever. And if you don't know how to quilt, we will show you. Now, if it rains, I've seen it when it rained and the people, ladies, didn't change. They said, you sit there and talk and quilt without having with the rain sign. So anyway, the Uncle Eli's Quilting Party is there. Please come down. Please resolute us, proclaim us, or do something.
I think we can just read
and
that
bring your feet back.
Do whatever we need to do that.
It's in the minutes.
There was no resolution. It was just Commissioner Vaughn moved to designate Uncle Eli's Quilting Party an annual event on the first Thursday in April of every year.
And on the top line, it reads the third Thursday in April is first. Those 08 minutes, third, first Thursday. Okay. Any questions? I'd love some questions.
I have a motion to do that again.
I think that you should have brought a chairman and myself for outfit, and we could have worn.
I wore them when I was a kid.
Trust me. Just to show it off.
You got to pick them out too. When you go up to Burlington, and you got to go pick out the one you wanted to have a dress made out of.
But that's it.
I'm aging myself.
Let me measure for size.
Not on that. No, I ain't wearing that pig. No. But anyway, I do have a motion that we accept.
I'll second that.
We okay. have a motion to second in my favor.
When will I see a road sign?
We'll talk about that.
We'll talk about that after class. Okay. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Come see us.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. At this time, I'm going to open the public hearing on the Jordan Lake Rules Buffer Ordinance, and I'm going to get Mr. Martin to come up and explain this thing, because I fell asleep reading it.
Madam Chair, Commissioners,
yes,
good evening. I do have in front of you placed there an updated presentation for tonight, and I will be very brief. It is a shorter presentation this time. But just to kind of summarize from the last meeting, we did call a public hearing tonight to discuss the proposed amendments to the existing watershed ordinance for the Jordan Lake Rules buffer requirements. And the recommendation you have in front of you is what came from the Planning Board at their February 22nd meeting. I will start off tonight by saying that I did speak with the Division of Water Quality at the state I spoke with one of their representatives and requested their attendance tonight and invited them to the meeting to answer questions from the public and from you all, and they respectfully declined. What they did send me was a 6-page summary of the Jordan Lake rules to give to you all, so I printed that and gave that to you in your packets. But I did want to start off my presentation by saying they were invited and they chose not to come. So, just to start, again, the picture I had up last time of this is the entire Jordan watershed. And just to summarize, according to the GIS department, Alamance County is roughly 435 square miles. Currently, we have 108 square miles of existing water supply watershed, and under the Jordan Lake rules, approximately 99.8% of the county will be covered with some form of watershed. Commissioner Sutton had asked for some information at the last meeting regarding the Cape Fear River Basin, and I did find a good map here of the Cape Fear River Basin so that you can kind of see how all this ties together. Also in your packets, you should have an information sheet about that where I gathered a little bit of information. It encompasses 27 counties, about 21% of the state's population, so it is a rather large river basin. And the Jordan Lake is the largest reservoir in the Cape Fear River Basin, but it starts kind of in the southern part of Rockingham County and drains towards Topsail Beach, Surf City, that area. Okay, and to summarize the enforcement area of what we have proposed on the map here in pink is the existing water supply watershed areas, which under this proposal, Alamance County would be responsible for enforcing buffer regulations in those areas, and that's where we currently enforce buffer requirements. The tan and green areas, that represents the city limits and their respective ETJ areas. That would be enforced by municipalities, and then the area that's in gray would be by the state. I felt like this would be a good visual to put with it. The applicability of the rules, the buffer requirements shall not apply to existing and ongoing uses within the buffer area. Buffer requirements shall not apply to farming operations. And bona fide farms are exempt from the existing watershed protection ordinance. So having that in that, it's kind of a double protection for farmers there. The difference, again, between perennial streams and intermittent streams. Perennial streams, that is a stream that's well-defined, and it contains water year-round. Intermittent streams contains water part of the year, typically in the winter and spring. And then we have to have some form of way to identify what is a perennial stream, what is an intermittent stream. And what we've proposed is to use the USGS quadrangle maps. And the solid blue line there at the top, that would delineate a perennial stream. If it's shown with a dashed point, that is an intermittent stream. And I did want to rework this a little bit to clarify. If you look at the map right now, the pictures we have here, at the bottom in black is the 50-foot existing undisturbed buffer on perennial streams, which is the current rule in the watershed protection ordinance, 50-foot undisturbed on all perennial streams. With this, it would actually change on perennial streams to a 30-foot undisturbed area, but it also adds intermittent streams. So it's actually a little bit of a loosening of the rules on perennial streams, but it adds intermittent. And then a 20-foot as area of managed vegetation, which would allow for some grading and replacement of routine maintenance, things like that. And so the grand total would be a 50-foot stream buffer on both perennial and intermittent streams.
So anything within 30 foot cannot be harvested or cut?
That's correct, and unless it's in the table of uses as being allowed, with the exception of, with the exception of routine maintenance, if you had a tree that was diseased or something like that, to keep from destroying the whole buffer, you could take that out and replant. The diffuse flow requirements, basically, in layman's terms, what this means is that runoff water cannot be run directly through the buffer into a creek. Can't run a drainage ditch straight to the creek. The ditch would have to be diverted before the buffer area, which would allow the water then to drain naturally with the slope of the buffer into the creek, and that's designed to serve as a natural filter. And this picture here is just it's one technique that can be used. It's called a level spreader, but it kind of gives you at least a little bit of a visual as to how that would work. The table of uses, I did want to include in here just briefly, there are 35 exempt uses in that table of uses, 39 of which are allowable, which means they have to have some form of designation that there's no practical alternative, which would be determined by planning staff, and then allowable with mitigation. And to summarize the mitigation, again, there's three options that the state has put forward, and that is payment of a mitigation fee to the Riparian Buffer Restoration Fund or the Ecosystem Enhancement Program, the EEP, donation of real property or interest in real property, such as a conservation easement, or restoration or enhancement of a non-forested riparian buffer. And again, all of these have to be within the Jordan watershed and roughly the same distance from the supply. Another point to make here were the civil penalties for violations. Currently in our watershed protection ordinance, there are three classes of violation, class 1, 2, and 3, class 3 being the minor violation, which is $100 per day fine. Class 2s would be $500 per day, and then class 3 or severe would be $1,000 per day. What the state recommended in their model ordinance, not to confuse anything, but what they recommended was $15,000 a day per day, not to exceed $200,000 for 30 days, or a class 2 misdemeanor. The
what
second one
constitutes that class 2 misdemeanor?
Basically, a violation, my understanding of this would be, negligent violation would be, I honestly didn't know I couldn't do this. And so it was just basically claiming ignorance of the law. The knowingly or willingly is basically, I know I can't do this, but I'm going to try my luck. And that's $100,000 per day, not to exceed $500,000 for 30 days, and a class 1 felony. And then knowingly violating would be a class C felony, and that basically would be the, I know I can't do this, and I don't care. So fine not to exceed $200,000 per day and not to exceed $1 million per 30 days. And that was a big thing with the planning board. They felt like those fines were a little bit steep, and that was another part of the logic of attaching this to the watershed ordinance. That's all that I have in my presentation. I do want to say, before I ask Phil Ross to come up and speak a little bit to you guys as well, I did want to say I know three of our planning board members are here tonight. I'd like to recognize them. Ken Walker, our planning board chairman, is here. Todd Lambert, who is an engineer in the county, is on the planning board and helped me tremendously with the diffuse flow requirements. And also Jane Isley is here as well. And she also serves on the Ag Oversight Committee for the Jordan Lake Rules. But I did want to make a point just out of fairness to my planning board as well. The planning board, basically, when we put this recommendation together, the planning board, if there was not the need to do something, they would have preferred to obviously leave well enough alone. But being that this was a state law that was passed, I do want to emphasize that this recommendation they put together, if they had their druthers, they would have been leave well enough alone. So,
before you sit down, Ken,
yes, sir.
Can you go back to the slides and make it a little more elementary for me, please?
Sure.
Go back to the perennial and the intermittent streams. Let's put a face on this rather than just words. Let's say Jane Isley's got a perennial stream running through her property and or an intermittent stream running through her property. What can she do now and what's required of her and what will be required if we pass this?
Okay. Basically,
I know you've already said it, but...
That's okay. I understand. If as a farming use, then...
Okay, non-farming.
Non-farming, okay. Non-farming, basically on a perennial stream right now, there's 50-foot undisturbed.
Okay.
can't disturb that at all. Under the new rules on a perennial, that would be a 30-foot undisturbed area, but an additional 20 feet, that would be allowed for grading and some revegetation and things like that. The big difference would be on perennial streams, intermittent streams. That is a new rule, because right now there are no regulations against intermittent streams. However, the other point is, if currently, for example, you have an intermittent stream on your property and you are keeping it trimmed all the way down to the creek bank. My understanding of this is, as long as you continue to do that, and you were doing that before this was passed, you can continue to do that. It would be grandfathered. But, for example, if you were to sell your property or to vacate your property and somebody come in and change the use of it, say I wanted to, for example, you sold your property and I came in and I said I want to set up a small business here, then the rules would kick in because it would be constitute a change of use and it's not ongoing.
So there would be grandfather.
Yes, okay. Yes, sir.
I've missed a lot of this. I apologize.
That's okay. Thank you for asking me that. I want to make it clear. So.
Okay. Going back to perennial, what's the logic of actually lowering the?
Basically, to keep uniformity with the rules, the Jordan rules. When you read them, the explanation that they give is that the county would have the option to make the rules more stringent. The option we could have taken would have been to say undisturbed on both perennial and intermittent, but by doing this now to lower that is to keep it uniform for both perennial and intermittent, so it's a uniform rule across the board.
But it does so-called improve or lessen quality, or it would lessen it, would seem like, if you want to buy their angle.
You could make that argument.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, well, while you're here, can you comment on the I don't know why we didn't see copies of this, but I don't know if y'all did, but the Raleigh paper had the Fall Lake debate. Is it Falls Lake or
Falls Lake?
Yeah, Falls Lake.
Yeah.
And it said that, you know, they're now having to deal with the same thing. Mm-hmm. And they were talking about Durham County. And Durham, I think, I talked to the reporter that did the article, and she told me that 2/3 of Durham was in the Falls Lake watershed or whatever, and 1/3 was in Jordan, and the article pretty much insinuated that Durham was going to fight this situation, and made the reference that if the whole area was forested, that they didn't feel like what they're trying to accomplish with the rules, the nitrogen and the phosphorus, if the whole area was forested, that they didn't feel like there'd be any improvement at all, and Durham's raising Cain over it, just to get that out on tape.
Yeah, and it's a very interesting article. I pulled it up on the News and Observer's website the other night, the night after you contacted me about that, and took a look at it. And basically, it sounds very familiar. I mean, it's very familiar to the Jordan
County. Yeah, I mean, another lake.
And it really, Durham is actually kind of getting a double whammy because a little bit of this is in Durham County as well. So they're getting it on both ends.
But for the first time, it was pointed out what Raleigh was trying to avoid as far as what money they would have to spend on quality control of their water. And it's just, it's obvious what's happening.
Yeah, a big part of their argument, what I took from that article, and again, I would recommend reading that as well, a big part of what I took from that was that basically the Falls Lake, their argument right now, and it sounds very familiar to the Jordan Lake argument that the local governments here made, is that, one, the state is saying, we want to implement these rules, but there's no guarantee that they'll actually work. And the science, and it's very, very, very familiar. And I think there's a point in that article, I believe, that they actually even say that the state is afraid that it will turn into a situation like the Jordan Lake rules was, where there was a compromise struck, and there's concerns that their rules in Falls Lake will be watered down, for the lack of better words. Very, very, very interesting article, and they are going about it very similar to what the local governments here did on the Jordan Lake rules. Actually, and I believe that their phosphorus and nitrogen reduction rates are astronomical with that too. They're like 40% reduction and 60% reduction, which there's there's folks that are saying that basically there's no way they can meet that requirement. So that's actually a little bit more so than the Jordan Lake rules. And also on top of that, that's in the Neuse River Basin, and there's rules that go with the Neuse River Basin that they're already implementing there. So if you look
Phase
at it,
Phase 2 has been in effect
and
for
they've,
years.
Right, and that was a...
I think, and they haven't even let that work to see what the results are.
That's correct, and that was a very big argument, particularly of the city of Greensboro, which is a Phase 2 community, and the city of Burlington, Phase 2 communities, that there was no time given to see if the new stormwater rules that they implemented with MPDS Phase 2 would even, if they had worked at all, which that was a big part of the Jordan Lake argument, and I think it probably will become a big part of the Falls Lake argument as well.
I think it's just a matter of government overstepping their bounds. The Constitution of the United States did not authorize the government to tell people what to do with their land. They're coming out to asking these farmers to sell 50%, 50 foot on each side of their ponds and lakes or the rivers, mm-hmm. Where they can't control. They can't even get their cows in there to feed them. And they're trying to, they offered them just a very minimum amount of money to buy that land. And once they give up that right to do that, they lose the right to control that property.
Mm-hmm.
Jason, is this a matter of clean water, or is it a matter of taking in more land?
I don't
have to answer that. Where do these fines go?
These would go to the school system. The fines, Clyde, correct me if I'm wrong on that, but
they
fines
would go to the State Board of Education.
That's right.
State Board.
Okay. It's not going local.
No.
Well, just in reading the lake history, I mean, I was going back, said this started in 1945. You know, when they were first looking at the Jordan Lake Reservoir, you know.
At constructing
it. Yeah, and constructed it. And, you know, all along they were saying, no, we're not going to use this water except for, recreation. And now, but it looks like when I read this that they had implemented this a long time ago, mm-hmm. that they wanted to do the clean water on it.
Well, and I've heard a lot of, again, it's hearsay, but I've heard a lot of older folks that are familiar with the Jordan Lake and when it was constructed and the planning process it went with it, say that very thing, that it was not designed initially for drinking.
This says it is.
But I've heard conflicting statements on that.
Right, and I don't know who wrote this, whoever
that
they.
That came from the state.
Whoever they, this
originally.
Is, yeah, so that's the thing that really bothers everybody, I guess, is that nobody ever thought it was going to be for drinking water, and it's going to supply Durham partially and Chatham and Cary especially, mm-hmm. With water.
Well, the Army Corps of Engineers said originally this would that would be drinking water.
Well, that's what I was looking at here. That's where they bought it. State bought it from the Army Corps of Engineers.
Mm-hmm. But I would like to ask Phil Ross to come up and speak a little bit about the ag rules and to kind of give a little bit of information to you guys on that as well and the process that they're going through right now. And as I know, I've had calls from farmers in the county and there's and rightfully so, there's a lot of concerns there, and I would like to have him come up and speak a little bit about that tonight for some of the farmers that are here tonight. So.
Certainly will let Mr. Ross come here.
Thanks for the opportunity to be in front of you all tonight. Phil Ross with Alamance Soil and Water District. The district and the Extension Office, all the ag departments have been working on the Jordan Lake rules pretty much since they started, and because it is so important to the farmers in our area. Part of the Jordan Lake rules is the ag rule, which is separate from the stormwater rules and other things. And this ag rule, what it does, it imposes a watershed oversight committee. And this watershed oversight committee is basically a group of individuals, farmers mainly, that live in the watershed. They are to come up with how the farming community can meet the 5% nitrogen and 8% phosphorus reductions that's required by the Jordan Lake rules. So far, they have started meeting. We had our second meeting today. Trying to figure out how are we going to be able to track nitrogen loss and phosphorus loss on farms. Basically, we have until May 31st of 2011 to come up with some type of tracking tool so we can do that. Some of the preliminary studies that have been done by Deanna Osborn with NC State, she's a professor that's dealt a lot with this and other watersheds, it pretty much shows that the farming community's probably already met their goals. The other thing is with the transfer or the loss of farms that we have in Alamance County and in this watershed, basically, they're probably going to more than meet their goals by just by the loss of farms. But with that being said, I think the Oversight Committee is looking at ways that they will be able to, you know, report the data that the state requires. The baseline accounting for the 5% and 8% reduction is due to the state from the ag community by May 31st of 2012. And if we meet the requirements at that point, then that's pretty much all the ag community is going to have to do, except for an annual reporting to the state showing that we're still meeting our requirements. If we don't meet our requirements by then a local ag committee is going to have to be appointed, and that committee will have to come up with ways that farmers can meet the goals. But with most of the research is done, I think we are going to more than meet our goals, because I started working in Alamance County in 1988, and the Ag Cost Share Program was put in 1985. The Ag Cost Share Program was put together and funded by the state to protect Jordan Lake. And we've installed a lot of conservation practices in the county since 1985. And all of that we'll receive credit for in the farming community. So I think, you know, all the fencing we've installed, you know, cropland conversions, no-till work, watering systems that have gone in through the ag department, home farms in our county will help offset a lot of the requirements that we have. So be glad to answer any other questions.
I got a question, Phil, and I think maybe some of the gentlemen on the back row might be here on the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's questions about the encroachment on things that they've had over the past.
Mm-hmm.
How that thing Bill was talking about, the state willing to buy 50 foot, is that something that I missed in the process here?
Pretty much in our county, what Bill's talking about, the EEP program, Ecosystem Enhancement Program, has been a program that has been in effect probably 10 to 15 years. But what happens with that program, whenever DOT destroys a wetland, they have to pay into a fund, a mitigation fund in the state, and then they in turn have to go out and look for areas to restore. And the easiest places for them to get restoration acres is on farms. And so generally what they will do, they'll come out and if a farmer is willing, it's all purely voluntarily, they'll pay for that easement along a stream, and it's 50 foot on each side of the stream is what they normally are looking at, and then they go in and reestablish that stream corridor to the natural conditions, and that's how they can get credit for repairing that wetland area. But the farmer is generally compensated at the land is appraised and they're paid for that. In most cases the farmer is also paid for the fencing to fence out the cattle, plus waterers if they need it, and crossings if the cows need to get from one side of the creek to the other. So all that's generally paid for.
The state would pay that
100% of the cost.
For that.
Yeah, so in some cases, depending on the operation, it's a very good thing for the farmers. And the farmers still do own the land. They have control on the access and everything, but it is an easement where it cannot be cut or livestock can't have access to it anymore, that kind of thing.
In your experience, how many times has this happened in the past? I mean,
we've had a lot of farms participate in this program, and for the most part I think the farmers have been pretty satisfied with that program. I haven't really seen where it has decreased the value of the farm, but it, you know, I can't tell you exactly how many acres are in the county, but it's several acres and the county's been installed.
Will this affect anything in the farmland preservation program that we're working on?
No, I think if anything, if the farmers are able to meet their goals of the reduction, one thing that the Jordan Lake rules do have that hasn't happened in any of the other watersheds is the trading issue. It may permit municipalities that can't meet their goals, they'll be able to actually trade with farmers, possibly buy easement and mitigation acres from farmers. If a farmer's willing to put in a buffer, he could sell that buffer area and be able to receive some funds from that from a town. So that is written into the Jordan Lake rules. I would think that would be several years down the road before that will happen, but it is possible that could. And that could help fund some of the farm preservation work that we're doing in the county. Because Durham County, their biggest problem is they don't have any farms left. And so there's no way they can meet their requirements because of that. And yeah, if they did, they may have a way that they could mitigate some of the losses that the town's incurring, you know. But any other questions? I'd be glad to answer.
This is a public hearing, so if anybody's got any questions, yes, if you'll come forward, sure, and give your name. And
my name is Roger Owens, and I noticed you spell out what we can do as far as mowing or cutting anything close to in the buffer zone, but nobody has said what we can do as far as fertilizing the fields close to the buffer zone, and what's going to happen if some of the fertilizer happens to get to the creeks.
Okay. One of you gentlemen can answer that, please.
In the Jordan Lake rules, there is a rule that pertains to fertilizer management, and if anybody has ever put out pesticides, you know, a lot of times you have to go to pesticide training with the Cooperative Extension to be able to do that. Well, with the Jordan Lake rules, it's going to be very similar. There's going to be fertilization management rules, and people that apply fertilizer are going to have to go to a training that they put out, you know, fertilizer properly. You know, it sounds simple, but you know, when you're thinking about putting out fertilizer, are you putting it out there on grass that can uptake those nutrients? And that's what the training will be about, is making sure that you're applying it correctly at the correct rates, and you're not applying it, you know, when you may have situations where it might run off.
Is this something you already have in the works, or is it?
Currently, Extension Service is developing the training for this, and they're supposed to, by 2012, August 2012, they're supposed to start offering classes on fertilizer management this kind
of time. So we got a couple year lap time that.
Right. So most of your landscapers and folks that are commercial type operators, right, they'll have to go through this training just like they do for pesticide training.
Yes, sir.
Let's go ahead and train. Most of what we put on the fields is chicken manure. You mean we're going to have to go to school now to learn to put out chicken manure?
Well, chicken manure is already regulated under the 0200 and 0100 animal waste rules. So most chicken farmers are already keeping up with the amount of waste that they're producing on their chicken farms. And if they sell an individual load of chicken litter, they have to keep up records with where that goes. And probably if you have chicken litter delivered to your place, there probably already has been an analysis pulled on that chicken litter of what content it is, whether it's nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. So that stuff's already been going on, and it's been going on since 1997 when the animal waste laws went into effect.
Boris learned something. I think Henry would like to speak to.
If you'll come up front, Ken.
You know where I get a chicken.
Good evening. Henry Vines from Southern Alamance. Talking about this fertilizer and distributor and all. Right now, we already, you know, as a poultry farmer, we have to meet these guidelines of spreading to nutrients and everything to, you know, to agronomic rates. The problem, I mean, and they set these rules, is now we're going to have to go get training that we already know how to do, you know, and we're already, you know, we've already got the guidelines set by state that we send off our analysis that tells us how much we can put down on grass and whatever crop. So, I mean, this is just another formality that we're going to have to meet, as we always, you know, we try to meet each one, then we have to meet more. But the 50-foot buffer that you spread the chicken litter and all, you know, back, you will have to maintain that. But they still haven't come up with any true gauges to tell us, you know, how much phosphorus is going to leave. You know, all indications that we've got right now through State College that phosphorus don't move. You know, it stays when it gets there. That's where it's at. But these are just some of the things that we're up against. But, you know, as far as our, and like we said in the meetings that we were in Lake Jordan Rules, we're not going to put no more fertilizer down than we have to. At $500 a ton fertilizer, you can't afford to, because, I mean, you know, that goes your profit.
Yeah.
And, you know, just common sense, it goes a long ways. Now, years ago when fertilizer was cheap, I'm sure that there was a lot of over-fertilizing that went on, but you can't afford that now. You ain't going to stay in business if you do. And as far as the chicken and poultry litter and dairy, you know, we've been spreading it according to state laws for years. And it's not going to really be a big change for us.
Anybody else have any
questions? Yes, sir. Hey, Ken Walker with the planning board.
I did want to share a few things about how we got to this point. When Jason came to us and asked us to consider this ordinance, our first reaction was to basically say no. We had had enough of what the state was dictating what our county needed to do regarding this Jordan Lake situation. And we asked Jason if we could say nothing, bring nothing to your board and tell the state no. And he informed us that we would be in violation of the law, so we thought that may not be a good idea. Our next reaction was to bring you a one-page document that was very short and to the point. And then we found out that would probably not be very useful either, because it would be more limiting to not only the farmers, but to everyone and how they could use their property. So the next phase was to really look at the ordinance that was before us from the state and see if there was anything we could pull out of it and use it in coordination with our ordinance that was already on the books. We did not want to bring to you a new ordinance. So we thought if we could modify what was already on the books in the county, that may be sufficient. According to Jason and to the planning department, the state, no matter what we do tonight, is going to dictate what takes place. We may pass the best ordinance going, and they may reject it. But we wanted to bring something that they would consider. Finally, and I don't think the planning department likes our idea, but we do not want the state to have jurisdiction on enforcing whatever ordinance goes into place. We think it should reside with this county. This county should make the decisions on what is acceptable and not acceptable. We don't need any more regulations coming from Raleigh telling us how to run our county. Thank you.
Before you sit down, and Jason, if y'all could maybe consult our watershed ordinance that we've got now, how does it compare to watershed ordinances in other areas, you know, more metropolitan like Guilford or more rural like Davidson or Randolph? You know, surely we all don't have the identical ordinance.
They're all actually pretty similar, and the reason being is when they passed a lot of the water supply rules, they sent out a model ordinance, and Alamance County didn't adopt exactly the model ordinance, but it was very close. Our ordinance is very, very similar to Rockingham County's. I think they've actually incorporated that now into their zoning ordinance or into their UDO, but it's very similar to theirs, and they held 50-foot undisturbed buffers on perennial streams. The state requirement for years, from my understanding, minimum was 30 foot on perennial streams, but Alamance County adopted a more restrictive ordinance, as did Rockingham County. Some other places, there's some differences in how they've chosen to regulate watershed areas. And there's other things, obviously, in the watershed protection ordinance, impervious surface requirements and minimum lot sizes and things like that. And Alamance County pretty much went the most restrictive route at the time, as did Rockingham. Again, ours is, two ordinances are very, very similar.
Is there a reason for that?
I think both, well, both of the two counties, they adopted a very similar farm preservation program to Alamance County. And I think just the fact that they both had a lot of similarities in their rural character, they adopted similar things. I can't say that definitively. I'm not sure what the planning directors at the time and the boards at the time, their logic was, but I would lend to think that having worked in Rockingham County and having worked here, they are very similar counties. So,
what if the planning department, you, i.e. us or whoever, submitted what we've got and said, we think this is tight enough, this is what we submit. That would be a submission. Now, we wouldn't be in violation of law, I wouldn't think, at that point. And
you know, one of the things, Tim, that was pointed out to us in our meetings, and we did not have a table of uses at all our first draft, and we went through a second called hearing just to discuss it further, because we said we don't want a table of uses. Well, without a table of uses, you really tighten the screws down on any usage. And so that was one of the reasons the ordinance was lengthened, was really to help people be able to use their property more than they can now. If you look at the municipalities around us, they've all pretty much adopted what the state sent down, and we weren't in favor of that. Now the state may come right back and say, too bad, Alamance County, you're going to adopt what we've sent, but I think we at least need to make an effort to send them something besides what they want.
We are going to send this thing.
We've already sent it, haven't we? Weren't we supposed to have sent that by the 10th?
In talking with staff, and so I know there was a lot of confusion amongst this board, we just basically sent them a letter and said, you've got something coming. We're having our public hearing tonight, and that we will be sending you something after the public hearing. But, you know, there was a lot of discussion at our last meeting about, well, should we send something that we know is wrong? Should we wait? And then after the meeting and talking with Jason and also with Clyde, we just thought it was very easier and cleaner just send a letter and say, you've got something coming after our public hearing tonight.
I know at last meeting we had said we were going to send them the revised and so forth and voted on it, but I'm fine with that. I think that's a wise move, really.
And Madam Chair, if I may, I can also say I know we aren't the only ones that did that. I know Orange County sent a letter to the state as well. Now, their logic was a little bit different. Their logic was our buffer requirements are more stringent than the Jordan rule, so we're not going to change anything. So they kind of went the approach that Mr. Sutton was talking about and just did it by letter. So that was Orange County's logic, but we're not the only ones that sent a letter.
Okay. Anybody else got any questions? If not,
I think I've got a question. Where do we go from here, though? I mean, we've got to make a move with something on this issue.
Madam Chair, if I
need to close the public hearing.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken. At this, did you have something else to say?
No.
Oh.
I thought.
Okay. And then, is that all right? Or do you have anything else to say?
I was just going to clarify that question Mr. Boswell had.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. At this point in time, I'm not requesting any kind of action to amend the ordinance or anything. Okay. Basically, I would say what we send is what the planning board has recommended, and then wait for the state's comments. They have 6 months to provide comments, written comments on this, and at that point we would need to address the state's comments, and we would need to hold another public hearing at that time, and basically either amend our ordinance. And I've gotten information from different people at the state. Some say they would like to see it amended into current ordinance. Some say they'd like to see a model ordinance. So at this point I say staff recommends sending what we have from what the planning board gave us and see what the state's comments are.
Okay.
They will be the ones to make the final decision.
Yeah, and basically they're going to, they will provide comments as to what we have to adopt at that point. And, of course, part of the conflict there is we have to, as a local government, we can't amend an ordinance or adopt an ordinance without a public hearing. So we'll have to do it at that point and hold another public hearing. And it's fair. I think it would be good for the citizens, too, to be able to inform them of what's coming at that point. So,
so at this time, then, I will close the public hearing since there's no more comments. Now, do we need to make a move on this at all, Jason?
I guess just a consensus okay. to send it.
Okay. Well, I'll make the motion that we send this what we've what the planning board has adopted for us to I think it's for what we have to do with it. I think it's a good bill, and I think the planning board needs to be appreciated by the work that y'all done.
They worked hard at
they
that
surely point. Did
and I'll second your motion, Bill, but I want to make
a second on favor.
Reluctantly an aye.
Okay, the next is David Leonard on the sole source purchase of equipment. How are you, Mr. Leonard?
Just fine.
Good. Thank you for coming tonight.
Yes, ma'am. Madam Chair, and those commissioners, mm-hmm. As I have reported to you, our office has been working to provide the emergency services agencies within Alamance County a mobile command unit. As I've also reported, a community policing grant, or COPS grant, was secured, and a portion of these funds have been used to purchase this vehicle. The vehicle was purchased from Farber Specialty Vehicles, which is located in Ohio. The unit is currently being outfitted with equipment requested by our emergency management office per the grant guidelines. To better serve our emergency service agencies, we would like to request that the following additional items be added to this unit. The funding for these items will be covered by the chemical planter contingency funds and will not expend any county tax monies. The total amount that we're requesting is $33,175. Below, and I've got a listing here of the items, it'll be a 32-inch status screen monitor. They'll install four 800 mobile radios, 800 megahertz mobile radios. They'll install an electronic copy board, which will be PC integrated with a fax, copier, and printer. A satellite dish with two-way internet access will be added. A siren and amplifier. A Whalen Mobile 800 mobile command strobe. They're also going to install, and this will be supplied by our LEPC, a 24-inch monitor and computer. Again, our local emergency planning committee will be supplying that 24-inch or supplying that equipment, but they're going to install it for us. Also, a wireless G broadband router, which will allow for wireless internet connection for any of the agencies that we'll be bringing into our mobile command center whenever we're taking it out in use on an incident. And also, it'll be wired with Cat6 network wiring, which will allow interface to all the computers that will be actually programmed in to our screen monitors within the facility. So we'll have that interface capabilities. I also come before you tonight to request that you allow the sole source purchase and installation of these items to the vehicle's manufacturer, Farber Specialty Vehicles. As you can see, the equipment that we plan to purchase is technical equipment and will require technical expertise for installation. Farber Specialty Vehicles specializes in installing and maintaining this same type of equipment that we're requesting. Several of the vehicle wall panels are currently being removed for the installation of some of the original requested items right now as we speak. With the removal of these wall panels, additional installation projects can be completed rather easily. This saves time and money on the installation. Also, Farber Specialty Vehicles will be warranting this vehicle and much of the equipment that is currently being installed, and they will provide us with technical support on the vehicle as well when we move forward with it. So it would be cost effective for us to have this one manufacturer providing the sole warranty for this vehicle. At this time, I'll entertain any questions you have.
Is this a van or?
Actually, it's a 36-foot motor coach.
Okay.
It's a fairly large self-contained unit that will be set aside, and we hope to have a presentation for you prior to us receiving it And once we bring it in, also we hope to bring it before you one night to show you everything about it.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, will that warranty cover the all this and the installation, and for what period of time that warranty be good?
There are several different warranties per item. Some of the warranties have a 1 year or 12-month warranty. The actual vehicle is a 3 year, 36 mile on the chassis. There's a breakdown of each item. Yes, ma'am.
And y'all are satisfied with
yes,
the warranty?
Yes, ma'am. We're extremely satisfied with the equipment and the warranties that we will be receiving on each individual item. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Anybody got any more questions?
Okay, at this time I'll entertain a motion.
Move.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor?
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you. Okay, the next thing is finance matters. We have a budget amendment to the health department. If Mr. Bass will come forward, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We have been in receipt of some additional funding in a few areas, and so hopefully for your present for your consideration. The first item that we have is for is budget amendment number 95, and that's for $3,558 from the Women's Health Division from a Division of Public Health, and we will be purchasing additional contraceptive supplies with that. We will be it also includes the availability for sterilizations for women who of low income women. We can use the funding for that, as well as oral contraceptives and IUDs and Depo-Provera. So we're asking to use the funding for our contraceptives and family planning program.
Okay. We want to do all these at one time, just going through them, Craig?
We can.
Okay. Is that
okay?
Yeah. Go ahead.
All right. Yes, ma'am. Number 96 is for $13,938.11, and this is for our environmental health section. And this is based upon restaurant inspections. So this is an earned revenue for our food and lodging folks for going out and doing not over 99% inspection rate. If it weren't, Carl was honest whenever they called him, we missed one restaurant, and the state had missed a report. So his honor, you know, but I say he did the right thing. But in this case, we will use that $13,938 towards the salaries and fringe of the people who performing the service. The next item is for item number 97, amendment 97, is for $1,500. And this is some money that we got from the U.S. Office of Health and Human Services Office of Women's Health. And this is for some special events that are going to be conducted during the week of May 9th through the 15th. The primarily of this $1,500 is going to go towards a speaker's fee that we're bringing in someone to cover the cost of that. Other costs associated with it would be for marketing and to support the event, and certain items that would go to the participants who show up. So it's $1,500. Again, this is non-local but federal money that we're receiving.
Okay.
And then the last item, number 98, is for $10,939.75, and this is from our the WIC program, and this will be used towards our breastfeeding peer counseling program, and we will be using these monies to contract for a breastfeeding peer counselor who would work with moms to help them learn how to breastfeed their kids, teach them how, and this will be a mom who had also been had breastfed her kids and would help the moms learn how to be comfortable and help them bond. So it's a service that we're going to be added for our WIC program. And that's all.
Any questions?
I got one on the one with the health department and lodging and stuff. With the new no smoking rules, how much more do you think that the health department's had to pick up as far as inspections?
Is it, well, actually, what we're doing is we're going out as people may call in, or they're incorporating it when they go out and do their inspections. Actually, for our environmental health staff, unless they get a specific complaint, what they do is when they go into a restaurant, they look around and do a visual inspection. So we're trying to tie it into what we're already doing.
Right. I didn't know if they were seeing an additional load from that?
Well, there is some additional costs because we're having to write letters to our violators and those kinds of things. And the interesting thing is had been brought up earlier in the course of this meeting tonight. Even though we're going to be levying the fines, the school gets the money.
Okay.
Any other questions? Do I hear a motion that we accept these amendments as we've presented? Have a motion.
Second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Thank you. Barry, before you leave, what is the policy on mobile kitchens around the community? I mean, we see these mobile kitchen trailers selling food all over the county. What are the regulations for monitoring there?
Okay, I'm not an environmental health specialist. However, to the best of my knowledge, they have to be tied to a facility somewhere as part of an operation. There's that I need to get back with Carl to know that answer truthfully. But they are inspected at some level. And if there's not one that's suspected, then the public needs to let us know.
On a yearly basis, too. So they got all the restrictions just like a restaurant.
They're supposed to have.
You can't sell hot dogs at a concession stand. Last time I went to a Cummings High School football game years ago, you couldn't sell hot dogs there because of the way they had to be prepared. I mean, you have to heat them and so forth and so on. I don't know if that's still true or not. But I would like to know exactly what we do with them.
Good question.
Because they're all over the county.
They are.
And in 1 month they might be sitting here, the next month they might be over here in a parking lot somewhere. And
well, if they see one, they're, you know, my understanding is they're good about going up and checking.
Tim, they went down in Hall River.
Did they really?
Yeah, they did.
Okay. I'd like to know exactly what we do with them.
Yeah, they got restrictions.
Yeah, they do have restrictions.
Do they have to post?
I was on that board a couple of years.
Do they have to post certificates?
I don't know, but all I know is they did close one down there.
They
did.
They
do.
So. Okay, well, let me know exactly what we do. What
I never went to
it.
Brad, that's
one that I've seen several times over at Walmart.
It is now gone.
In West Burlington.
Oh.
Across from the...
Well, there's one over here, and it's now gone.
Okay. But I've seen this one frequently. Mm-hmm. Don't go that often. But,
yeah, but to my understanding, that one had been looked at, because that's close to... The one close to our office.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And it's gone.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I did notice that this week. Okay.
That was good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barry.
Okay. The next thing is a budget amendment for recreation.
Good evening, Commissioners. Budget amendment number 99. These funds represent the final payment from the insurance company in regards to the fire that occurred at Pleasant Grove in June of 2008. So we're very pleased to receive this money and are preparing to start work on the center. We're getting the plans back end of this month for the design work and to lay everything out. But this is the final payment.
I had a question this week, and I talked to Craig, and he said probably about 30 days.
Yes.
Is that about right, Jim? I didn't have a question Wednesday.
Should be sent out for the renovation of the gym, and then should be sent out within 30 days.
Okay. Okay. Any questions? Yeah, I'm entertain a motion.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor? Okay, thank you. Next part is budget cuts. Yay.
I'll be doing that one. Attached is the $1,017,704.20 budget amendment that would place cuts from the departments as we discussed at our last meeting. We're doing contingency lines separate from the department's current budget for your approval. This does not include any funding from ABSS or from mental health at this moment. But we expect those hopefully to come by our next meeting.
Okay. Any questions on this? If not, do I hear a motion we accept this?
So moved.
Transfer.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. That's good. Okay, the next is the documents for the facilities improvement projects.
I'll be doing that one as well.
Okay.
In your packet, you have three documents. One is the escrow deposit agreement, along with the deed of trust, which assigns the collateral, and also the installment financing contract for the Group B projects. The installment financing contract is with RBC. And again, it is for $5.9 million, using $3 million of Recovery Zone Economic Development Bond funding. And that $3 million has a 2.975% interest rate. And we also have $2.9 million of Build America Bond, which has a 3.51% interest rate. Currently, if we borrow the bonds without using the stimulus money, the interest rate would be 5.41%. So by going through the bond route and using some of the stimulus programs that are available on the life service of our debt for these projects, we're going to save over $672,000.
Great.
But we do need a motion to be passed that will authorize by resolution the persons named in Exhibit C, and that includes the county attorney, the county clerk, the chairman, and myself, and the finance officer, to execute and deliver on behalf of the county the contract and all other documents and instruments contemplated by the contracts that need to be signed. And I believe we're closing on the final loan on Thursday.
Pre-closing on Wednesday.
Pre-closing on Wednesday.
Any questions on this? Do I hear a motion that we accept these finance documents for the facilities improvement projects?
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Uh-huh.
All right. Next is the, we need to set a public hearing for economic incentives.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I would like to introduce Mac Williams, who is here tonight on behalf of the Chamber, to request that we set a public hearing for April 5th with the Board of Commissioners to consider an economic incentive request.
What he said.
Okay. Well, what date, April 5th?
Yes,
the hearing would be April the 5th. And tonight I'm asking that you consider setting setting that as the official date for the public hearing. And in concert with the new procedure that this board adopted with respect to this process, as you know, the change was that the identity of the company for which the incentives would go would be disclosed at this meeting. And so after you set the date, then I'll be happy to let you know who it is you're talking to. I guess that would be the...
Okay, I'll make a motion that we set the date.
Saturday, April 5th.
April 5th.
I always want to see what she looked like first.
That's all right.
So, I have a motion and a second to set the public hearing for economic incentives on April the 5th. All in favor?
Aye.
And in keeping with your policy, the company is TriVantage, which is a division of Glen Raven.
And what are they going to do?
Well, they'll tell you all the details on April the 5th. But in keeping with that, that is who they are, and I'm sure you can call Glen Raven, and they've got somebody there who's prepared to take any inquiries and provide any information that you might have. But the public hearing is where most of the details would be provided, and someone from the company representing the project will be here at that time.
All right.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, Mac, before you go, talk to us a little bit about Piedmont Triad Partnership. I saw this letter that was dated March 1st, and it said we were one of seven regional economic development partnerships in North Carolina, and that we were 37th in the United States and so forth and so on. Ken, and that you'd gone to Chicago and some good meetings to try to help market our area better. Mm-hmm. In this region. Tell us a little bit about that, and how are we marketing this area? Are we marketing this area nationally? Is there a firm hired that helps us? Or can you talk to us a little bit about that?
We haven't hired a firm. We do it through the Piedmont Triad Partnership. They are one way that we market ourselves, our county. We sometimes partner with the Piedmont Triad Partnership and go on trips or participate in events that they set up on our behalf. Over time, the economic development people that are in this 12-county region have been successful in different sectors
of the economy, and so they will go out, and the day being the partnership, will go out and try to find trade shows where this particular sector is active and where we might have a presence at those events. The Chicago trip that you referenced was simply a one of many trips that the Piedmont Triad Again partnership will set up, and we will go call on site selection consultants. As you know, in your time over your tenure here, I have more and more come into the situation where when I'm working with a project, and that was the case with this one that we're about ready to do on April the 5th, it came to me not directly from the company, but rather through a third party, a site selection consultant. And they used a code name. In this case, it was Project CDC. And that's the way they referred to it. I didn't know who it was up until about a week or so ago. And that's very typical of the way companies are doing this process now. They'll use a third party, and they will be anonymous for as long as they can be for lots of legitimate reasons. And so what we do a lot of the times that we market through the Piedmont Triad Partnership is to go where the site selection consultants are. And many times they're in the major cities with international air hubs, big accounting firms. The accounting firms and real estate firms that are national in scope are opening up divisions within their operations that focus on either doing site selection consulting or some aspect of it, incentive negotiation or the real estate piece. And so we just do outreach. We go to the partnership has gone. They go to Chicago, Atlanta, New York, Los Angeles, Dallas. These are places where a lot of the site selection consultants headquarter themselves.
Is there a national database or even an international database that spotlights different countries and continents and so forth that tell what the access to water, roads, other modes of transportation, labor rates, availability, and so forth, so on? Is there anything?
Well, there's certainly a lot of information on the internet at various levels. At the county level, tends to be the most uniform level with the broadest geographic footprint. Because what these consultants do is, as best they can, they try to compare apples to apples in terms of locations. Here's a location over here, and here's a location over here, and they try to find data that's the most comparable between the two. But that's just data. They are employed to come and do more investigation, and that's when I get contacted often, is to update stuff, put a different, not a twist to it, but to add more context and dimension to a figure than just the raw number. There's always a story behind a number. And so that's when they come and do more investigation of the labor market, oftentimes an interview, a conversation with existing employers will be part of that. They'll come look at the real estate. Because at the end of the day, all economic development occurs locally. And so you can look at research at the state level or at the international level or at the county level, but at some point it's going to go on a specific parcel somewhere. And so they eventually drill down and do a lot of homework at that specific parcel level before they make a decision.
And I'm not giving this, and I'll be quiet, but I've been wanting to talk about this for a little while. I was talking to some friends of mine down in South Carolina, and I said, my gosh, how are y'all getting all these major companies? What are you doing? And, of course, the state's doing unbelievable. I don't think it's local governments that are doing that much, to be honest about it. But the state's just throwing out the gold. I mean, just putting it out there, basically. But I was told that from some people that say they know a little bit about what's going on, that those companies are going where the wages aren't as won't be as, in other words, that people in South Carolina don't expect to be paid as much as maybe some people where if that plant had gone somewhere else. Do you buy any of that theory at all?
Well, I buy into the theory that there are regional differences in basic wage levels for different kinds of jobs. So yeah, there's a difference among regions and they're not uniformly defined. It's not like the country got set up into a quadrant, and it's these amorphous sort of geographies that fit together, and there are labor rates that are consistent in one area that you go to another area that might be a little higher or a little lower, but over the differences in wage rates in different parts of the country aren't nearly as wide as they used to be. The gap between the wage rates down here in this part of the world versus upper Midwest aren't what they used to be.
Do you buy the theory that people, industry coming over from Germany, they're coming here because they pay a little less wage here, possibly?
I don't buy the theory that anybody locates or relocates based on one thing.
Or part of
what I buy in is that they look at a wide range of things: wages, taxes, incentives, real estate, logistics, infrastructure, growth, the communities, whether the communities are growing and the populations are expanding or shrinking. They look at a wide variety of things and make their decision based on the synthesis of all of that stuff. And I will also say to you that what is important to one company won't necessarily be this important to the next, because they're all individual projects, and what's driving those decisions is all individual. There's no template to what they look for and what they make their decision on, because they're all unique and they're all being driven by different things for different reasons.
Last question. What percentage of our workforce do you think in this county would be classified as a service job versus career high tech or manufacturing, or they're in the service? I don't even know. There's a better word for it. But
right.
I think you know what I'm trying
probably
to
about say. A third.
A third of it.
Yeah, or maybe even a little higher. It used to be that in this labor market, historically, I remember reading some numbers where we were back up in the low 30s in terms of the percentage of the population that was employed in manufacturing. And that percentage has decreased over time. I think we're now in the low to mid 20s as a percentage of the population for manufacturing, which means, but the population is growing and the labor force is growing, and so there's other sectors that are growing as that one is shrinking. Government, healthcare, education tend to be ones that are growing, but the service sector with retail jobs and other things, or business services, is also growing.
Appreciate it.
So thank you for that. And just so that you know, going to the city of Mebane tomorrow night and asking them to consider the same thing for the same project.
I do want to let Kim know that we are represented on that. I went to that meeting last Monday.
Okay, yeah.
And we're not represented on the executive board because we don't contribute $25,000 to the Piedmont Triad Partnership. We only contribute what?
About $14,000.
So what they've done, they've merged together.
They've reorganized and restructured.
Exactly.
They've reorganized and restructured
and
got new management.
Instead of having the floater, like when they used to have when somebody from here, and then the next year that we wouldn't have somebody, or a couple of years, I don't know how that worked at that point. But now we had to vote on a representative from 10 of the counties, because there's only two counties out of the 12 that contribute the $25,000. That's Guilford and Forsyth, okay? None of the other counties contribute the $25,000. So what we've had to do was vote on, and I didn't know any of them other than one guy that I met, because I had never been until last Monday. And so, and there's two women is all. The rest of them are men that I saw other than the staff. And the other woman is from Rockingham County. And, of course, they don't contribute $25,000 either, but we voted, and two men got it that I don't have any clue who they are. That one will be on the executive board for, and we suggested that they only stay on a year, and this is what we've suggested to the Mr. King, who is now the head of it, and that they only stay on a year and to rotate every year a new person, so all the counties, the other 10 counties could be represented. I have not heard anything on that as yet, but I will let you know.
Yeah. The state has this, what did it used to be, four divisions, now it's three, or is it four as far as?
That's the tiers.
The tiers.
The tier system.
Can you explain that a little bit to us? I know we've seen it before, but I mean, was it, did there used to be four? Or
used to be five.
Five, okay.
Yes, sir.
And now there's only three.
That's correct.
Okay, and which one are we in?
Two.
Now, can you define two? I mean, it's my understanding that the way the tier system works is the state has some analysis as how, for lack of better words, desperate your county is for jobs or industry.
That's a good paraphrasing, because that's exactly sometimes the way I try to explain it to people is, okay, for lack of a better term, it's how desperate are you.
All right, so which is the worst rating? One?
One, and then one is the most urban, and three is the
rural.
Yeah, I believe that's correct.
So they're saying we're kind of mediocre as
but
far
we're
as
in the
our
middle. Yep. We're in the middle.
Okay.
One is the worst, and three is the highest.
Three is the highest. Okay.
More urban. Like Scotland County was a tier one. So
yeah. Okay, and we're tier two, and what that does is to. Within the state legislature, there's always been this urban, rural, eastern, western fight, or that battle. And the state, in its policies, tries to balance out a balanced growth state.
Mm-hmm.
so that our long-term pattern of development in this state is more dispersed and spread out all across the state. And they try to set up state policy to encourage that dispersed, balanced growth. Irregardless of what the market and the clients want, at least they're trying to set up state policy to give those less developed areas more opportunity to enjoy some of the opportunity that comes along. And so to do that, the tier system was set up, and where a company might engage in state tax credits, the requirements and the thresholds that are considered in the amounts of the credits are all different depending on what tier you're in.
Exactly.
And so that's the reason for it and how it's set up. And we're actually a more competitive tier than either of our neighbors on either side of us, because they're tier threes. And we're tier two. So to the extent that a company wants to take advantage of a tax credit and is looking at that part, we're a little bit of an improvement over that. But again, that's just one piece of a big puzzle, and it may not be the deciding piece at all. But it's the way it's currently set up, and it went from five to three because it was just, I think it became, there was all this shuffling around of counties every year. Some counties would go up a notch and then down another one, down two or up two, and I think it just became very confusing to the ultimate end user to figure out what was going on, much less the local people trying to figure out which they were in. And it's based on a series of factors that the state legislature looks at, including population figures and probably a handful of demographic statistics and income and education statistics that are the basis for forming those tier systems.
Okay. Well, thank you, Matt.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Matt, I got a couple more things if I could. Oh, before
the consent agenda, we're not through.
Yeah, just a couple things. We did get a request in late from the sheriff for some out-of-state travel. He has a request to attend the graduation of Robert Wilburn from the FBI Academy in Quantico, Virginia. He is the first Alamance County deputy to graduate from the academy, and the sheriff would like to attend. The request came in late. Its reason is not in your packet, and the total cost on that is $164.50.
Was he sleeping in his car?
One night hotel and 2 days a meal.
Some bargain rates here.
Okay, can we put that in the consent agenda, or do you want us to vote on that now?
If you'd like to vote on it now, it would be
okay,
fine.
Okay, I'll hear a motion that we allow the sheriff to go.
I'll
have a motion and a second. All in favor?
And I do want to mention a couple of meetings to make sure you have them on your calendar. I put it on your list of meetings the other day, but just make sure the public is aware. Remember April 5th, which is our budget workshop, will be held at 8:30 in the morning at Main Memorial Library. We may not have a big breakfast, but we will have coffee. So,
what about park?
That may be an issue, actually.
Yeah.
Is taking care.
We can park behind the Woodville Forest in that lot.
Okay.
If there's no spaces in the library, there's a space there.
That's why I love Pat. She takes care of everything.
Do we want to pull anything from this consent agenda?
One more meeting?
Craig's on
there. One more. I'm sorry. Just also to remind you of April 8th, which will be the ribbon cutting for the Civil Courts Building. And that will also be at 8:30. Should take about 30 minutes.
Okay.
Coffee served.
May or may not have coffee.
And you got anything else?
No, ma'am. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Okay. At this time, we'll go to the consent agenda. And does anybody want to pull anything from that?
I don't want to pull this, Madam Chair, but I would like to bring it up that we do have a resolution in there for motorcycle riders.
Right.
And just want people to be aware that a motorcycle is on the road from personal experience. Wrecks are no fun, so just be careful.
Do I hear a motion that we accept the consent agenda?
Please.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the next thing. And at this time, we are going into closed session. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318-11 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners. Make your motion.
I make a motion we go into closed session.
And a second?
Second.
All right. In favor?
Before we go, I was going to bring up about five or six things. I could do it after the closed session, but I was wanting to definitely ask Susan Osborne a question. If you can stay,
sure.
If you would, and I guess that'd be okay. All as far as people.
Okay.
Goes.
Okay, we will return.